Welcome to the Revelation of Jesus Christ. You might be wondering, why do I call it the Revelation of Jesus Christ instead of the Revelation of St. John or the Apostle John, as most Bibles do? And I do because this is how the book begins. It says, the Revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his bondservants the things which must shortly take place. And he sent and communicated it by his angel to his bondservant John. So it is the Revelation of Jesus Christ. Notice, not the revelations, but the singular revelation. And so we've got the first verse, but now what do we do? Where do we go from here? How do we approach this book? And there are four basic approaches to the book of Revelation. The first one I made mention of in the first video for this week is the preterist view. And very quickly, the preterists just believe that the book of Revelation comprises the entirety of the first century, or that it's completely fulfilled in the first century. There are two kinds of preterists. There are the evangelical preterists who believe that John wrote this early, and therefore it was a prediction of the things that happened during the rest of the first century. And by early, I mean mid-60s, no later than 70 AD, certainly before the fall of Jerusalem and the temple. So then there's the liberal perspective of the preterists, which believed that this was not prophetic, but that it was written after the fact of the events of the latter part of the first century. And so this is presented as a prophecy that the liberals say was not prophetic, but more history. So that's the preterist view. Then there is the historicist view, and the historicist believes that Book of Revelation corresponds to the entirety of the church age, that when you go through the different episodes, you should be able to look at the episode and say, this episode corresponds to this particular event in church history. And they do that. There's some tremendous charts that they do that kind of spell out just exactly where the different events fit in. Then there's the idealist or symbolic. The symbolic view believes that the events that are mentioned in the book of Revelation will not happen in a historical manner. They never will occur, but that they are symbolic of the kind of things, the kind of struggles that Christians go through throughout the ages. And then there's the futurist view. The futurist view is a belief that most of the events of the book of Revelation are all in the future. They will take place during these 7 years of the Great Tribulation, and then they will be fulfilled with the millennial reign and the consummation at the end of the age. They also have great charts on that to kind of show the chronological movement of the entirety of the book. Now, that brings us to another question. How do you break down the book? And for this, I'm going to give you two different outlines. The first outline is on two pages for you because it's just so many. And the reason I choose this one is rather than organizing it through a bunch of different headings and subheadings and down from there, it gives three headings, the beginning, the Patmos vision, then the letters to the seven churches, and then the climactic events of history. And as you take a look here, through this screen and the next one here, there's a lot of events. That's one of the things about the book of Revelation, why it's so challenging, is there's just so many things that are going on, so much it's kind of hard to get a hold of. And so the charts try to do that for you, is to show all these different things and how they fit together. It's amazing how some of the creativity that is used in the organization of these charts. But I want to give you this because I want you to be able to see that you can just read the book of Revelation and use an outline like this just to follow what is the next event, what are we going to, without it being outlined. And then I give you another outline that is by Dr. W.J. Erdman. This is somewhat more simple outline. It starts with a prologue and ends with an epilogue, the word before, the word after, but there are then seven groupings of time. There's the seven churches, the seven seals, the seven trumpets, the seven personages, and on down the line. So what you end up with is seven groups of seven seven itself being symbolic in the book of Revelation for things that are perfect or completed. That's the finality of this book, that all the events of the book of Revelation, all the events of church, of human history will be summed up in these end time events. So, a couple of points about this. First off, some of these are enumerated, the first, seventh, second, third, fourth, and onward. And some of these, a few of these aren't. The seven personages are not enumerated. The seven dooms are not enumerated, and the seven new things are not enumerated. But he makes the point that you find these different groupings of seven within those passages. This might be helpful to you. It's somewhat helpful to me, as particularly as I take a look at this outline of Dr. Erdman's and put it together with Dr. William Hendrickson's outline from the book More Than Conquerors. Very similar, but what is particularly helpful to me in Dr. Hendrickson's outline and in his book is the idea that these are not seven groupings of a long chronological unfolding that takes place, one event right after the other on onward. Rather, these are seven different groupings of the same time period, that the seven churches would be during the time period of the Great Tribulation. The seven seals are during the time period. And there isn't a sense in which he gives a pretty good argument for the idea that there is a consummation that takes place at the end of each of these seven periods or seven groupings here. For example, you have still in the middle of the book in chapter 14, you have the harvest that takes place, where we get the picture of the grim reaper with the sickle. And the idea here is that this is it. It's the end. And they're bringing in the consummation of the ages there. And then it goes on and continues onward with the next of the particular seven visions. This is a decent argument for saying, look at this as seven different pictures of the same time period. That's blasphemy. Each instructor, each professor is going to give you their own spin or interpretation. I think it's blessed them in helping to get a hold of this. And I just wanted to share these with you. I want to end with a couple of thoughts here. First off, the main point of the whole book, if you want to sum it up, it's a war between God and Satan. And the summation of it is, Jesus wins. If you belong to Jesus Christ, you're born again, then you can say, the book of Revelation means, we win. And that's very important in the midst of all that's ahead, to recognize that we're going to be able to say we're victorious, no matter what happens to us, as long as we're faithful. So that's one thing I want to give to you. The second one is the blessing that is promised. Some say there's a blessing in reading the book, and actually, that's not completely true. It says, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of the prophecy and heed the things which are written in it, for the time is near. It's not a blessing if you read. It's a blessing if you read and heed. So as you read through this book this week, may you be blessed as you take a look. May you be challenged and may you be encouraged. When it says to him who overcomes, be an overcomer. Be one who is victorious with Jesus Christ. And so the book of Revelation I give to you. This is the end of our time together. It has been such a blessing for me. I hope you've gotten something out of these videos. It's been able to bless you in one way or another. God bless you in your future studies.